has more than 50%, they're supposed to send you a refund check. I haven't got one yet, but that's, but some people have actually, you know, they have gotten refund checks. But that's still 15% compared to 3%. So, but a single payer system, if, you know, if you're a small business and you, and your second biggest expense is healthcare, your first biggest expense is payroll, your second biggest expense is healthcare, why wouldn't you say, this is that every year we can't control the cost of this, it's raises 9-10% a year, it just is so expensive. If I'm a small business, I would say I would welcome a well-run single payer system to come in, and if we just had to pay a little bit more in taxes, but it actually ended up being cheaper than what I was paying in healthcare costs, I would support that.
What would it take to put in place a single payer system?
Well, I don't think that it's going to happen anytime soon, and I'll tell you why. I think Americans have just got they really don't even know what Obamacare is going to do, and I think that we're going to have to spend about 10 years figuring out Obamacare. And I don't know that Americans really have the palate to go into a whole other discussion on healthcare change. I really don't. I mean, I would support it, and I would push for it when I was there, but I just don't really see it happening. I don't know what you guys think, but it's...
They love it in Europe. And
they do.
And I don't understand why it's so hard to...
Yeah, you always hear horror stories, right? You're going to hear horror stories no matter what healthcare system it is. Somebody has a knee that they need, and they couldn't get it for 3 months or something else. But there are many horror stories in our own country. Because we have two healthcare systems. We have a healthcare system for people that have good insurance, and then we have the other healthcare system. And there are so many people that don't get anything. And this is the best place in the world to get healthcare if you have money. It really is. If you need to be separated from your Siamese twin, or if you got a weird cancer, where do they send people from around the world? They send them to the United States because we have the best trained doctors, we have the health, we have the best facilities, and the best equipment. But you could be in that other segment of our population that doesn't get any healthcare, and then in that case, it's worse than many other countries.
How many don't have healthcare in the United States? What do you think?
Well, yeah, I think it was upwards of 50 million, but the Affordable Care Act is supposed to cover maybe 35.
And they go to emergency rooms when they need help.
And that costs you more money every time you go to the emergency room because you're just
so then they would vote for a single payer either, but why pay when they get it free in an emergency room?
No, I think that's true. Yeah, I think most of them would. Yeah. If you had to live your life going to emergency rooms for your primary care, and you had to wait, you know, 8 hours when you're sitting in there, and only go in when you have that real big problem. I think that people are not, and they also delay going there because they don't want to. You know, they wait till the problem gets worse. People want good healthcare, and I, you know, you look at it.
Pays to buy it. It really does.
You only have one body, and it's got to last you your whole life, really. So I think that that's a basic right that people should have the same health care as anyone else. You know, it's
another question. Companies, I think they want to the conservatism wants to privatize health care, Social Security, and both Medicare. How can we stop them from doing that? In other words, it's a for-profit. It's a for-profit system that. The for-profit healthcare, right, is terrible. I think everybody should have healthcare, and they shouldn't earn.
Well, the only way that somebody makes a profit on your healthcare is either by charging you more money or giving you less healthcare.
Yeah.
That's the only way that you make more money.
Right.
So
right.
Both of those go against what we probably all believe in. But I think that right now, if you hold this, you know, and we've seen national polls on this, people don't want to change Medicare or Social Security. They don't want to change it. You get some radicals on one side that say let's revamp the whole thing, but nobody wants to change it. They know, you know, even if you don't use it yourself, so even if you're younger, you know people have their grandparents that are on it. They know that what it means to them, and I think that they want to leave it as an earned benefit, and that's the way that I would always stand up for leaving it as an earned benefit. And that's not free. It's not an entitlement. You earned it because you paid into it all your life, and then when it gets to a point where you can't work anymore, you deserve to get it.
Is it still being used for other purposes?
Social Security money does come out sometimes, but Medicare doesn't. So I do support on the Social Security side. it just doesn't make any sense to.
That's a lot of money too. What percentage is that of people for the 600?
For $106,000?
Yeah.
Maybe 5% of the people make over that, maybe more, maybe 7.
Yeah, it's supposed to be raised next year to 150. So there'll be a higher cap.
But it should take the money out of the lobbyists, I don't think you can get the money done. It's just money, whoever has the most lobbyists, they pay the most.
It's follow the money, that's what it is. And you've got, you have it on two sides now. You just had it on one side before, the lobbyists. Now you've got it on the other side with all these super PACs that just became legal. And you're, all these TV ads that you see are really super PACs. You know, we've even had super PACs jump in on my race. I mean, there's a couple of super PACs supporting me. One's got a mobile billboard running around in the community saying goodbye Medicare, and it says Buck McKeon voted to end Medicare, and it says that 4 times in a row, and underneath it, it says Buck voted to end Medicare 4 times in a row. but it's you know, yeah, it's a super PAC doing that stuff, but I don't agree with all of this independent money, this unlimited amount of independent money coming into political campaigns. I think that the only way to stop that is by public funding of campaigns, like they should be doing in the presidential races. If they don't take it. And that way you would say, okay, well, look, you know, for every $100 that you raise, the federal government will match that $100 up to a certain point, and then at that certain point it ends, and it's done, and you have to make your message other ways. Not buying your message. You have to go and get interviews in the media. You have to go out and meet people instead of just, here's my mailer. We send out mailers. Who brought this? Where you brought this? But you send out all these fancy mailers and then you don't have to meet with people. That's not right.
Australia has a 1 month period where they go through all this. We go through this in 2 years.
That's awful.
That's awful. Why can't we use the Australian system that says, hey, if the TV stations have to give free messages from candidates, and it's a 1 month period, and they tell you what they're all about, and then you can vote. And we go through this.
It's never ending. It's a never ending. And it's almost like Christmas, right? Because Christmas never, now it's like they never stop selling Christmas decorations.
That's right.
But we, I think that, so my case, for example, I've been running for Congress for 16 months, and it's it takes a real big toll on your family. It takes, and most of this has been, most of this has just been raising money. Like I'm on the phone 6 hours a day, calling people asking them for money, because that's what it takes to run and win. Now, in Congress, they keep talking about how they're increasing the diversity in Congress. So you get more women in Congress, you have more minorities in Congress, but the one thing you don't have in Congress is any poor people, because you have to be independently wealthy to be able to run for office, because you have to take off like 12 months of your life. Who can afford to take off 12 months of your life and go out and run and raise money, you know, from, you have to know wealthy people to be able to give you money. That's one of the things that's wrong with our political system, is that, you know, look at the people that are running, and they have to be able to, luckily I'm able to work, I work 2 half-days a week, and I can support my family just working 2 half-days a week, and at least pay the rent and just pay the food, not really do much else, but that's it, you know. But you can't get anybody, you can't have a normal job and run for Congress. That's wrong.
Influence money is a big part of this.
Special interest.
Yeah, special interest. And the average American has to regain his democracy from these corporations that now rule Congress, basically.
Right.
How do we do this? I mean, do we need a civil action on this? Or
Well, one of the things that I've supported, again, on my list of things I want to do right away, is I would sign on to, and there are people already talking about a constitutional amendment to overturn this Citizens United versus the FEC rule. This is the thing that allowed all this money to come back, unlimited amounts of money, and in some cases anonymous money, so you don't know who's spending it.
It's just like money rules, and how can you combat money? You know, that's the thing. It almost leads you to believe that you need some civil organization or some civil unrest to march to Washington and do something about it. Otherwise, something's going to happen.
Did you have something else?
I do have one question. It's in regards to education. education. I know you recently are a new father, congratulations.
Yes, thank you.
And so my question is about public education and teachers and how, where you stand on all of that.
Yeah, I've been through a lot of education. I've had 24 years straight of education, which you know, and I've got the student loans to prove it, if anybody wants to see it. But it's, I think that our, one of the reasons why I moved with my family to Simi Valley, I was recruited to Southern California to come and open the center at McDaniels. One of the reasons why I moved to Simi Valley, which is probably the same reason why some people moved to Santa Clarita, was good schools. And I think that a lot of people who are my age, who have kids that are going to be going to school, they consider that in the places that they move to. And you have to have well-funded public schools. There's two propositions on the ballot right now in California, because California's education system is so broke. And I'm not even sure which way I'm going to vote on both of those yet. It's a state issue, it's not a federal issue, but it's both of them kind of, you know, one kind of conflicts with the other. Top 30 will go for both higher ed and K through 12. Prop 38, which is the Molly Bunger Act, it only goes until 12, K through 12. But I just don't trust that the people in Sacramento or in Washington just spend their money well. The Prop 38 actually, that takes them out of the loop and just gives the money directly to the school, so Sacramento's not even in the loop. Prop 30 doesn't do that, but I have a real hard time with those. I really want to make sure that we have good schools, and I want to make sure we have good teachers, and I want to make sure that our teachers don't teach to tests. Instead, they can teach students individually, because students are different. And it's not an assembly line with my Chevy, for example. It's not every student that comes out is going to look like every other student, and you can't expect them to perform at the same level when they get out. And I think that's one of the complaints that the teachers have right now, is that's what the federal law that's giving money to schools, that's what it's calling for. It's calling for everything to be uniform. And it's not that way in education.
That's why I thought you gave this question.
Thank you.
Because it goes to the schools. Yeah. My granddaughter is now almost ready to graduate from a two-year state, you know, school. She is having a tremendous problem finding a school that they can afford and that she can withstand.
That would take her credits from the other school,
right.
Four-year college, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, the California used to have the best university system in the world, I would say. And now every year you hear about students protesting because they're raising the tuition by 23%, and it's unbelievable that they can do this. I know that this isn't the whole problem, but I do have a hard time whenever I see presidents of schools getting paid like CEOs of big companies. That just doesn't sit well with me. I don't know what to do about it, but it just leaves a bad taste in my mouth when you see them making millions of dollars to be a president of a school, which is an educational institution. And they can make, you know, you can get a president, I'm sure, a lot cheaper than that can be a good educational leader and not have to.
Are you talking about higher education?
Higher ed, yeah.
Yeah, because it's not.
Not below the schools, no. But higher ed, these presidents, they make a lot of money.
They do. And they,
you know, and sometimes the highest paid person in the whole school is the coach. You know?
Yeah.
But it's, you know, you have to look at it and you have to say, what's best for the students? And here's another thing that costs students so much money. Maybe your granddaughter ran into this. Textbooks are unbelievably expensive. And every year they take, look, for physics didn't change in the past 50 years. You know, gravity is gravity. They figured it out a long time ago. And so they, all they do is they just put a few new things in a textbook and they charge them like $180 against this textbook. Now we have iPads. Everything's electronic. There's no reason why information like that shouldn't be free or nearly free. And especially when you're paying this kind of tuition to go to a university. The university should develop their own curriculum, not make students pay all this money for these books. Now we have big textbooks industries, which also, again, have a lot of money, that are lobbying, right? But it's, you know, you're gonna have to send people, it's like I said at the beginning with this whole judgment and trust issue, you're gonna have to send people to Washington that you trust as a judgment to
office, at times we sometimes have problems getting answers back or receiving any type of information from him, regardless of, you know, what party, political party you belong to. For some reason, that's always a problem with his office. Can you tell us how your office would be different than that office?
Yeah, well, first I can tell you how my office works now. I don't ask anybody if they're Democrat or Republican when they come to my office, if they need help. If they need help, I help them. And I also really, you know, I am a Democrat, but I don't have this party identity that, because I'm younger, and I just don't feel like either party is really leading, and I feel really it should be this group of moderates in the middle that controls Congress instead of these people on both edges. And it's not like the Democratic Party is in here, you know, helping me out a lot, you know, from Washington. So I don't really owe anybody anything. And I think that's good. But, when you said that, I was smirking because the Signal just endorsed McCain, which they have endorsed McCain every, you know.
It was a little lukewarm.
Yeah, did you read it though? One of the things in their endorsement was that he really has gotten in a lot of trouble. He really hasn't been around much. But his staff answers the phones really well. I think that was the
And they also said, well, if he doesn't do any better in the next 2 years, maybe he should think about retiring.
He did say that, yeah.
And it was such a lukewarm endorsement.
And if you look at the past endorsements all the way back to 2006, every time they call him out, they said, now that he's in Congress, and now that he's in the majority and he's a leader, now we're so happy because he gave the CMEX bill. You know, and every time it's the same thing over and over again, and nothing happens. And, you know, but his position changes. He always has a better position every year. And so, you know, you have to, constituent services are one of the most important parts of being a congressman. Your job is to make the federal government work for people back home. That's your job. And that's either by passing legislation or by when somebody has a problem with their Social Security or somebody has a problem with their passport or any of these other things. That's your job.
Are you speaking to the students at the colleges around here at all?
I did some, yeah. They have to watch this stuff.
But he is so busy raking in the money from the defense industry because he wants to increase the army and build more tanks, which we never use.
Yeah, you saw that.
And he's getting a lot of money. He doesn't have to bother with the rest of it, really.
CNN, you refer to the CNN report that just came out the other day where CNN cornered him. He doesn't ever like to talk to anybody, but CNN cornered him. And they said, General Dynamics, there's up in Furlong, California, in the desert, there's 2,000 tanks sitting in the desert. One Abrams tanks, just sitting in the desert. And the Army says, we don't really need tanks anymore. You know, it's nice to have some tanks, but they said tanks, but no tanks. You know, they said that we do have some tanks, that if we needed to go into battle again with tanks, we would have them. But this is a different, we're fighting different enemies now. So, yeah. So, anyway, McKeon wants to refurbish all these tanks. And the initial price was like $3 million.
Wow.
He wanted to take all these tanks, and they would take them all to Ohio, and they would refurbish all these 2,000 tanks and make them ready to go into battle. And General Dynamics is the one that does this. Now, if you look at it, so CNN asked him, they said, you know, General Dynamics gave you $56,000 last year. And he says, and he had a grin on his face, you know. My dad would call it some type of grin, but I won't say what kind of grin it was. But he had this grin on his face, and he said, really? You know, they said, yes, Congressman, we assure you that they gave you $56,000. And they said, does this have anything to do with the fact that you want to refurbish all of these tanks? And he really didn't have a good answer. And he says, I just want the military to have what they need. And then they said, aren't we getting new tanks anyway in 2014? And he said, yes, we're getting new tanks. We need to get these until then. And so he said, so then they said, CNN asked him, well, who's going to get the contract for building the new tanks? And he said, well, General Dynamics, of course, you know. So it's, you know, yeah, this is the, and look, we have.